And welcome back to Let's Play Torment Tides of Numenera Blind. I am the RPG chick, as always. If you have the berry slaps, come see this lady. I use that term loosely. Going to the trading post, finally. Advancing the main quest. We don't have much to do. Go to the trade post. Find the mall that leads to the trade post. Return to Dracogen with the magnetic amulet. Magmatic amulet. Which I think is at the trade post. Although it doesn't say so here, it's funny. The only thing we have left to do here, the only thing besides going to the trade post, is entering the fathom, which I have to find a way to, you know, die again so I can get back to the labyrinth in my mind and to do that. I had heard that you should be of a relatively high level when you do that, and I feel like we're getting close to the end of the game, guys, so the next time I die, I'll try to do that. I haven't really said this very often, but hopefully I die soon in this game so I can do that.
I'm going.
Here we go, trade post. Cool. I like how every time you go to a new area, there's a different...
Making a note.
A different, what do you call it? Loading screen. Quest updated. Ooh. Yeah, that's... that. I would not step near there. A scene of horror lies before you. The walls and floors turn against the inhabitants of this chamber, opening toothy orifices to drag them down and devour them. Judging by the half-devoured wagons and other debris, this was a market of some kind or a trade post. I'm thinking trade post. To your left across the room is a massive slumbering maw. Its mouth gapes open and a portal shines within. Well, our left? Well, technically the way we're standing, our left is over here. I'm guessing you mean that, we came through? Oh, tongue cluster. Alright. This place is nasty. Oh, it did mean our left. Where's that go? Ooh, to the Ascension. Oh, wasn't he talking about that? We're supposed to find some place called the Ascension? This toothy orifice is frozen in the act of devouring a table. You notice small notches in the wood on one side, tallying sales or days spent in this nightmarish place. A mouthful of thorny fangs gapes in the floor. It's dormant now, but the teeth are wet with blood. The fleshy ground is torn here, revealing a mass of glistening, boneless creatures. It's not clear if they're parasites or some foul progeny of the bloom. This gaping orifice must have opened beneath the wagon, and bloom tendrils pulled it down. Ew. This round orifice is rimmed with rows of razor-sharp fangs. Human flesh and hair cling to some of the teeth. This reminds me of the mouth of there's something in our world that looks like this, some kind of worm. Maybe a flatworm? I'm not sure. Flukeworm, maybe? Yeah, nasty. Kind of leaves an impression on you when you see this round mouth with teeth. All it has to do is close and all the teeth come in, and it just looks nasty. Behind the massive glands that block the doorway, you see nothing but solid flesh. This chamber has been cut off from the rest of the bloom. Wonder if we can get through that chamber somehow. Alright, avoid the teeth, if you can. Or if I walk into the teeth, I'll die and I'll get back to my thing. Well, I can talk to the tongue cluster. That's interesting. I can get some loot here. Let's go over here and get the loot. There's loot over here as well. Let's go this way.
Fair enough.
Because, you know, just got to talk to that thing, right? 33 shins. Let's just grab this so we don't forget. I wonder if that thing was going to grab us. 44 more shins. We are rich. Did I take that? It didn't make a sound. I guess so. Yeah, I'm wondering if we're gonna have an option to buy some, like, expensive stuff, because we have 4,331 shins. And when I came here to the Bloom, I had, like, what, 30, 40, 50 to my name, maybe? I'm gonna talk to Tongues. Bloom Tongues. A wriggling mass of tendrils rises from the ground. Ugh. They remind you of the tongues that surround a maw. Writhing and twisting around each other, they make wet, unpleasant sounds. Ugh. Who would try to talk to these things? We're gonna touch them. Okay. As you draw near to the cluster of tongues, the voices of the Bloom begin to chitter and hiss in your ears. Listen carefully to the Bloom's voices. The hissings and chitterings are completely unintelligible to you, if indeed they mean anything at all. Same. Touch them, yeah. Carefully reach into the cluster of squirming tendrils. When they touch your hand, they pass through it, and a prickly, hot-cold sensation runs up your arm. You notice that the Bloom's tongues are much louder when you are touching the tongues, the Bloom's voices, rather, although you can't understand them any better. Well, there's not much here to do, huh? This place has really gone to hell. There's nothing to interact with. So I guess we're going into this Ascension. Okay. Let me just... I wish I wanted to go here. I found my way to the trade post where an open maw leads to the Ascension. Now I need to search the Ascension for the magmatic annulet, which Drakogen described as a dark hyaline circlet. Okay, I know what dark means. I know what circlet is. What is hyaline? Codex. For Bloom Tongues. Ooh, all of a sudden the music comes back. Alright. Characters, companions, creatures? Bloom Tongues. Bloom Tongues are wriggling tendrils that sprout from the flesh of the Bloom. Usually they surround maws, but sometimes clusters of tongues exist on their own, especially in the deeper chambers of the Bloom. If you draw too near to a mass of Bloom Tongues, their voices will intrude upon your mind. Hmm. Especially if you listen to them like that. Okay. Let's go and leave the area.
All right.
To the Ascension! It's been less than, like, 10 minutes in this place. Wisdom, enlightenment, and mysticism. Cool stuff. That's why I'm tied with gold. I've been for a while. For a while I was pure gold. Codex entry unlocked. The Ascension, yeah. You emerge from the portal into an alien world. The air is thin and bitterly cold. The sun is a tiny white globe in the sky, casting dim light over a landscape of crystalline beauty. You see no sign of organic life, only glittering crystals in every direction. Let me guess. They're sentient. Calistia says, what I would have given to see the nucleation of this world. It must have been amazing. Indeed.
Wow.
Some stuff to look at. Well, I wonder if there's going to be any fights here. Okay. So I hit C for codex, but of course that goes to character sheet. Locations. It's under T for the Ascension. Wouldn't think so, but... The Ascension of Kex Leonish is a world of stark crystalline beauty, located far from the Ninth World and accessible only through one of the Bloom's Maws. Lights flicker within the crystals, some of which have strange intricate shapes. The Ascension's sun is small and distant, leaving it in a cold, perpetual twilight. Explorers and merchants occasionally venture here, but they are few and rarely stay for long. Okay. There's a Duran over there.
Why not?
Let's go this way. Dead end? Is this place reacting to us when we move like that? Making those sounds? Well, it looks like we have to go across this bridge or something.
Of course.
Place seems pretty big. Although a lot of it's taken up by, you know, stuff we can't walk on.
Fine.
Looks like we're talking to Duran? Sounds familiar. We talked to a Duran before? Random explorer.
Allow me.
Finally, a new face! Where did you come from, stranger? Asclarion. And explorers. Alright, we'll talk to him. This tall, weathered man nods to you. He holds himself stiffly, as if something will crack if he moves too quickly. He glances at your tattoo and smiles. Hello, Castoff. I am Duran, prophet of the Changing God. It's been a while since we've seen anyone come through here. What's your business in the Ascension? Not going to give myself away. They might be looking for the same thing. I'm just exploring. I understand. What else would bring anyone to this destitute place? Anything we can help you with, friend? You don't hear any thoughts from his mind at all. It's just quiet, as if something is carefully and silently listening from the dark reaches of his head. Oh, he's a prophet of the Changing God? What can you tell me about this place? Very little, he says, blinking. There are crystals, there are lights, there is no one to talk to, and little of value to find. It's a lovely world, but I fear we may be wasting our time here. Sure you can tell me anything about the Ascension? There is little to tell. It's a beautiful place, but devoid of life. What are you doing in the Ascension? Seeking, he says in a studied, casual tone. We have it on good, though possibly outdated, authority that this place holds more of your father's secrets. We've found nothing yet, however. Until we do, we are enjoying the sights and the silence, the crystals and the lights. He shrugs. Our pursuits have taken us to less pleasant places. What does it mean that you're a prophet of the Changing God? A title only, he says, bowing his head in momentary respect. The cultists of the Changing God believe I have a special connection, because I have found some well-hidden secrets of your father once. He shrugs. Between you and me, I just got lucky. Are you related to the cult of the Changing God in Sega's Cliffs? We are cultists of the Changing God, yes, though I'm afraid we have little to do with our colleagues in Sega's Cliffs. There is not a light of oversight between our churches. What secrets of the Changing God did you find? He waves it off modestly. Nothing that would interest you. An old workshop of his with some trinkets? I didn't understand any of it, but the cultists were ecstatic. They drafted me as a prophet and confiscated everything. Well, he winks, everything I didn't sell first. For fair compensation for my efforts, you know. I'm not going to ask him this because he's probably seeking the same thing. If he's not, he's going to want it once he finds out it's here from us asking. So farewell. And farewell to you. Alright, random explorers, and we'll talk to Esclarian. I serve the Prophet Duran. Speak to him, not me. I'd keep moving if I were you. No offense. Are you lost, little cast-off? Yep, I'm lost. I thought I was in, you know, a special place of the bloom where there's no bloom. This shelter is built from a variety of exotic materials. Sin steel, pliable metals, and adamant silk. It looks like it's been here a long time and has probably served many different groups of explorers. Asclarian? This tall, lithe man has an unkempt shock of bright red hair. His skin is ashen, as if colored by the dust of old tombs. It's been a long time since he's seen a real sun. His smile is thin and twitching, and a demented light burns in his eyes. Another cast-off, he says with a sneer. Another echo. Who are you? Asclarian, he says the name proudly, as if you should have heard of him. I act. He falls silent, his eyes glittering with contempt. What do you mean, you act? The Prophet Duran hears, he says, nodding at the man standing nearby, and depending on what he hears, I act. He eyes you, fingers curling at his side. Why did you call me an echo? The strong are those who act, he says, closing his eyes as if quoting from memory. They change the world, break the sky with their thunder. His eyes open, dark and disdainful. And then there is the echo, a weak imitation of the source's fury, claiming to be more important than it is. Cast-offs are echoes of him and deserve none of his glory. He thinks, I've heard of other... What? I can't speak. I've heard of other cultists who worship the echoes. Fools, all of them. The source is what matters. There are many cast-offs. Even if you think we're weaker than our father, don't we have a large effect on the world? What tie did I get here? Indigo and blue, both tiny amounts. Yes, he says, raising his eyebrows. His lips twitch again. Certainly. An echo has power of its own. It can shake mountainsides, create avalanches that bury villages. He smirks at you. It doesn't make the echo clever. An echo simply goes where it is sent. You're really going far with this, what would you call it? Metaphor. He thinks they're all the same. They all want to impact the world, while their father simply does. Can you tell me anything about the Ascension? I can, but I won't. The Prophet Duran will decide what you're allowed to know, Echo. Huh. So you do what Duran says? No, he says sharply. I act on his words. That sounds an awful lot like taking orders to me. It would to you, he snarls. One of his eyes is twitching now. He's triggered. You don't know what we are. We do not tumble about the world like you do, inflicting little damages or claiming to be more than we are. We listen. We decide. He takes a long, shuddering breath, calming himself. Then we act, but no one tells us to do so. You think all cast-offs are echoes of the changing god. What are you, then? A man like him. A man of action. Even your questions are echoes, he sighs, looking away. You're an echo because you're not the source. It's simple. Farewell. At least he's polite still. Alright, so there's nowhere to go but here. We shall see. There is some interesting stuff to see here. Can interact with this? So, we came from here. The builder. Encampment. The speaker. Huh. How do we get to these other areas? Well, there's a bridge down that way. I see.
Ready.
This massive crystalline structure looks like a shrine of some sort. Colored lights float about inside, each one like a tiny galaxy trapped within the crystal. As you approach, the crystal begins to hum. The resonations shake your skull. The humming shifts and increases until you hear a voice. Revel. The bright voice echoes directly into your mind. It stutters, uncertain, like someone trying to remember how to speak. Greetings, Pattern One. I am the speaker. Welcome to the Ascension of Kex Leonish. I am sorry, but the Oracle no longer exists. The lights pulse once, then a much deeper voice emanates from the crystal. Revelation. The Oracle was immortal. Time was the weapon that killed her.
Then wasn't immortal.
Something clicks or cracks within the crystal, and it speaks with a bright voice again. I regret that without the Oracle I have very few answers for you, but I will do what I can. The thoughts you receive from the structure are not like any thoughts you have experienced before. They come fast and incomprehensible, but more than that, they come from all around you, from underneath, and even above you. It's as if you can hear the thoughts of an entire world through the speaker. These are like some, like, I'm guessing these are some kind of, like, vast computers. Form like with crystal and energy. I mean, I've heard of such things before. Not that they really exist, but... Why did you call me Patterned One? A few of the lights pull together, creating a glowing circle in the air. No, not a circle. A pentagon, like your tattoo. Patterns are what we do, Patterned One. Life is pattern, and your life more than most. Your thoughts hold a certain shape, a shape I've seen before. The lights twirl and chime wistfully. A man came through here long ago. He did some work here, I believe. Or maybe came to hide something or find something. He never revealed to me his true purpose. I think I know who that might be, then. The one sending us on his quest. What was the Oracle? You are standing on it, or rather, what remains of it. The Kex Leonish built the Oracle to answer the most difficult questions of existence. The voice grows wistful. Then the Leonish left. The Oracle remained for 100,000 years or so before it broke down, I suppose. All that's left of the Oracle are the Phobits. Phobits. Several sharp clacks resound within the crystal. The deeper voice says, Revelation. The Phobits were not always sentient. Cogitation. Would they have become so if the Oracle had not chosen disintegration? Chosen disintegration. So the Oracle was the wisest intelligence in thousands of worlds. It was a crystalline brain, built out of the entirety of the Ascension, where you are now. The Leonish built it to answer their most difficult questions. Now the Oracle is gone. What are Phobits? The lights dance within the crystal in a manner you can only interpret as proud. We are the Phobits, the sparkling lights you see inside some of the crystals. If the Oracle was a brain, then we were its neurons. Each one of us had our own job, our own specialization. You can't speak to the others, of course. That is to say, they're perfectly intelligent, but they're entirely unaware of you. The only reason you and I can speak is because of my role as speaker. The others weren't made for communication or perception. The speaker throbs. The deep voice cuts into the air. Revelation. Common phobits were used to store activation states and simple information. Some may still react to basic physical stimuli. If the Oracle was a brain, we were its neurons. Each of us had a specific task. Mine was communicating with intelligent beings. There are billions of us, though very few can speak to you like I am. What does it mean that you are the speaker? My full title was once the speaker for the Oracle of Kexleanish. It says the name with soft reverence. I heard questions from pilgrims, relayed them to the Oracle, and then conveyed the Oracle's answer via revelation. I gave wisdom to this entire world. The crystal's light dims. Now I speak for no one, and I have few answers to give. The deeper voice speaks again. Revelation. When the speaker dreams, it dreams of weeping. Sometimes the tears are made of light. Others, tiny black gems. What happened to the Leonish? I do not know. They left one day, abandoning the Ascension entirely. Perhaps they ascended to a higher form of life. In any case, they did not need the Oracle anymore. I do not remember much about them. Remembering wasn't my responsibility, only speaking. All I know is that the Leonish built the Oracle out of this entire world, used its knowledge, and then one day, they left forever. Can you read my thoughts? No, but I can taste them. Among other things, that's how I know to speak in your language. Do you know anything about the other humans over there, Duran and his companions? I do not, nor do they know anything about me. I will not speak with them. Its answer is surprisingly curt. Why won't you talk to the other humans? The lights inside the crystal dim slightly. I do not trust them. They don't taste right. You hear a sound in your mind remarkably like a clucking tongue. I cannot explain it. Well, then I'm glad I wasn't telling them about the magmatic annulet then. So maybe I was right not to trust them. Revelation, the deep voice adds, above a chorus of brittle snaps from within its body. The speaker tastes a strange pattern to one of the humans. Two patterns of thought where there should be one. Two patterns. Yeah, I said there was something like... Like, I automatically tried to read Duran's mind, and there was like another mind inside his waiting for something. You said revelation in a different voice. What does that mean? You are mistaken. Speakers are not authorized to grant revelations without the Oracle's permission, and the Oracle is no more. You hear another crack from deep within the crystal, as harsh as ice breaking underfoot. The deep voice speaks again. Revelation. The speaker cannot hear itself give revelations. It stutters and falls silent for a moment before saying in the bright voice, I wish that I did have some revelations for you, Pattern 1. Alas, that time is long past. I wonder if that's the remains of the Oracle. It's not aware of. Kind of reminds me of Event Zero. I don't want to give spoilers, but... Something inside the AI that the AI is not aware of. And you get to speak to at some point. Pretty interesting. I'm looking for something my sire hid here. Do you know where I might start? I apologize, but I do not. Investigation was not my specialization. Only speaking. The crystal vibrates once. The deep voice speaks. Revelation. The speaker can speak to all sentience, even those that did not exist at the time of its creation. If the other phobits are sentient, then could you speak to them for me? Or at least make them aware of my presence? Of course, but they know nothing. I don't see what interpreting would... The speaker trails off, pulsing thoughtfully. No, there is a way. They can help. Several Phobits in the area were in charge of transmission tracks, communication pathways connecting the Oracle's smaller subsystems. When the Oracle passed, those pathways became obsolete, and their Phobits quiescent. But those tracks could serve as bridges to help you explore the area. Yes, that could be very helpful. The deep voice booms. Revelation. Like humans, the Leonish also required physical structures for traversal. Only a few Phobits specialize in areas requiring this knowledge. The speaker is not among them. The speaker's bright voice returns. Try to interact with the Phobits. When you do, I'll ask them to activate or deactivate. They might not all be as helpful as we'd like, but I think you'll find some way to get around. Okay. Farewell, patterned one. We can't go down there.
Yes.
The crystals light up and sing into your mind. Greetings, Pattern One. It is good to see you again. How nice.
Fair enough.
So we can speak to these Phobits now, I'm guessing.
Naturally.
Where we couldn't before, like here? Right. This is the only one we can physically get to.
I'm ready.
This is pretty cool. Sweet. I like that.
Go.
Well, let's see what this is. And loot.
Ready.
39 shins and a hyper-elutriated force, which heals 6 points of might. Sweet. I always use stuff like that. We have 3 of these now. Sweet. We have a good amount of stuff. Consumables. Oh, we'll interact with this thing.
I'm ready.
Is this another Phobit? Sweet.